Hello.
Testing 1 2 1 2. Your mom's.
That's gonna go. I'll put that in.
Please.
Okay. Hello, my name is Ryan, and you are listening to The Crime Cast. In this show, we will be talking about true crime cases, unsolved mysteries, and cryptid creatures from all over the world, from the mountains of the Himalayas to the suburbs of Los Angeles. In our third episode, we will be talking about one of the most famous paranormal cases in the U.S. That is the case of the Conjuring House. This house became famous after paranormal team/couple Ed Lorraine Warren investigated the house back in 1971, and it became a movie series called The Conjuring, released in 2013, with the newest being released in 2021. Before we start this episode, I want to introduce our first guest/co-host to the podcast, Libby! Libby! By the way, this episode will be the dumbest episode ever. Libby, introduce yourself.
Hi, I'm Libby.
Now introductions are out of the way and your moms have been said. That was really loud. Let's get into the history. The old Arnold Estate today, known as the Conjuring House, is located in Harrisville, Rhode Island. The estate sits on about 8.5 acres of land that includes a river, open field, and a forest, almost all surrounded by a stone wall. Before this house was built, the land was inhabited for thousands of years by the Nimuk tribe. Nimuk tribe and other local tribes until the land was bought by Roger Williams, who I believe was a Quaker. I may be wrong. Miss H is watching this. Okay, I'm sorry to all history teachers out there. He would move to the property, and the property originally had around 1,000 acres, but he would sell that land because this man wanted money, clearly. This house was built in 1736, 40 years before the signing of the Declaration of Independence. And this house survived a total of 3 wars on the property: the King Philip's War, Revolutionary, and the Civil War. Now let's get into the Perrin family.
Buy the house in December of 1970 after Carolyn Perrin discovered the house by accident in June of 1970. Carolyn, alongside her husband Roger Perrin, would move into the farmhouse in January of 1971 with their 5 daughters, Andrea, Nancy, Christine, Cindy, and April. One of the strangest things that happened to the Perrins was when they were given the keys of the house, the previous owner would tell the family, "For the sake of your family, leave the lights on at night." With that warning, the parents would move into the house and live there for about 10 years.
Unlike the movies, the parents did not have a son, because this film, because of course we all know Hollywood, they just like to exaggerate every little detail about everyone's life. Now the hauntings would begin immediately with the first sightings of spirits being friendly. Carolyn would notice things such as the broom moving around or going missing. The girls became fond of 2 of the nicer spirits. Those spirits belonged to Mrs. Arnold and Johnny Arnold, who the girls called Manny. It is reported that Mrs. Arnold would tuck the girls into bed and give them kisses on the head, while Manny would play with the girls' toys and watch them from afar as they played outside.
Believe that both Mrs. Arnold and Johnny hung themselves, with Johnny hanging himself in the attic sometime in the mid-18th century, and Mrs. Arnold hanging herself in the barn. Another spirit that haunted the family was named the Sweeping Ghost, since they would hear from the distance the sound of a broom shuffling across the floor, and when the family went to investigate, the sounds they would find in the...
the signs.
And when the family went to investigate, the sounds they would find the broom leaning against the wall next to a small pile of dirt. Even though the spirits were friendly to the parents, they also believed that there was a malevolent entity in the house. At around 5:15 a.m. most mornings, the family would be visited by the spirit and smell like rotting fish. Flesh.
They have the same smell, I will say that.
Visited by spirits that smell like rotting flesh. I would lift the family's beds, tossing anyone who was in the beds. As well as the smelling of rotting flesh, the parents also reported the demonic forces at the farmhouse would pull on the girls' limbs and hair during the night. Banging doors and disembodied cries were on a regular occurrence.
Daughter's book entitled The House of Darkness, House of Light, she hinted that one of the spirits, quote, "Let's just say there was a very bad male spirit in the home with five little girls," end quote. If you don't understand that, then you need a life because, well, I'm not going to say it, but you should know. If you don't know, then, like I said, get a life. The family also reported they heard voices telling them that seven dead soldiers were buried within the walls of the farmhouse, which we will get into later on with paranormal investigators and YouTubers going to the house. Now let's talk about the most famous spirit of Bathsheba Sherman. Bathsheba. Now many people, when they first saw the movie, believed that this woman was made up. And in the movies, she was played by a man, which is really creepy. But this woman was actually real. Bathsheba Sherman, at the time was known as Bathsheba Thayer, was born in 1812 in Rhode Island. Sometimes during her early 30s, Bathsheba would marry Judas Sherman on March 10th of 1844 in Thomason, Connecticut. The couple would have a total of four kids, with only one being confirmed, Herbert L. Sherman, as the other three died before the age of seven. This is why most of the neighbors / residents believe that she was a real life witch. At some point during her life, there would be the death of an infant on the property, which is well known in the movies, because in the movies you hear like the little kid crying. Right? Or am I just thinking of the other movie? The cause of death was an incision at the back of the head, with many of the neighbors believing it was Bathsheba who killed the infant as it was in her care at the time. This is how Bathsheba was accused of being a witch, which this basically made the neighbors believe it even more.
It's said that once Bathsheba died. How do you say it?
Bathsheba.
It said that once Bathsheba died, her body was turned.
The demon, into just call stone. Her the demon at this point.
It said that once the demon died, her body was turned into stone. Because of her horrible time in her life, Andrea Perron believed that the spirit became an evil spirit, that her spirit became an evil spirit in an afterlife. The parents would claim that Bathsheba would move the kids' toys and make their things disappear, which had a particular hatred towards Caroline Perron. This is because Bathsheba was infuriated by Roger Perron and therefore wanted Caroline out of the way.
It's infatuated. It was infatuated. What? Basically, this demon ghost lady took a liking to him, which is seen in the movies, and she wanted to pursue him. Ghost having sex. We love that here. If I was a ghost, I would not want to have sex with anybody.
Bro!
Now, Roger was actually the only parent that experienced the nicer side of Bathsheba with Caroline would experience objects disappearing on her, and she reported being physically hurt and emotionally tormented, believing that maybe Bathsheba was trying to possess her, which gets more into the movie side. At this point, they decided to call up Ed and Lorraine Warren. Yay, we love them. I probably will do a separate episode on them and their most popular cases, including the Annabelle doll, the Amityville Horror House, and the one where the little kid gets possessed and then the other guy gets possessed. Whatever that one's called. Ed and Lorraine Warren would form the New England Society of Psychic Research in 1952, and also creating a museum of satanic objects and demonic artifacts that they found from their cases, which back in 2020, if you remember this, people thought that Annabelle, the fucking haunted Raggedy Ann doll, helped. And we're just wandering around, going on tour. Shane and Ryan were looking for her, apparently.
Sam and Colby who?
But now, those rumors are fake because that girl is locked up like she should be. Lorraine Warren believed that at around the age of 7 or 8, she was able to see people's auras around them, which sounds like some Harry Potter witchcraft stuff. While Ed had grown up in a haunted house, and he became a self-taught demonologist, which is basically a person who studies demons. Now let's get into the real case of The Conjuring. Really? Okay. Movie spoilers. If you haven't seen The Conjuring movies, then don't watch this. But if you want to know the real story and then watch the movies, go right ahead. I don't care.
Just want to say, for those of you who haven't seen the movie, I highly recommend it. It's a very good movie.
The second one is the best.
I agree. Back to The Conjuring. After experiencing these hauntings, the parents would call on the Warrens to investigate their house. As soon as Lorraine entered the house, she had immediately sensed the dark spirit living in the house. Sounds like some voodoo witchcraft. Lorraine would also point out a small circular incision on the back of Caroline's leg and would identify it as the handiwork of Bathsheba, also stating that the Caroline's wound possessed the same characteristics as one found drilled into the infant's skull that Bathsheba was guilty of. Caroline told the story of how she got the wound. She had been lying on the sofa and all of a sudden felt a piercing type of pain in her calf, and then she began to muscle spasm. Upon examination, she noticed a puddle of blood at the point of impact. She checked for bees or anything else that could have caused the puncture in her leg, but she found nothing.
And that was an excerpt from Adrian's, well, that's the guy from Miraculous. Andreas. Yeah, but yeah. Damn. Okay, so after their first visit to the estate, the Warrens would declare the house diabolically infested, with all of its inhabitants in danger of falling under Bathsheba's power. So Bathsheba was basically like controlling the house like a puppet master.
Yeah. That's just weird to think about. Puppet master.
No, just like imagine you go in a house and all you see is like...
No, for real though, bro. What?
Insert, what's a popular line? Insert Pinocchio.
So due to the copyright issues, I cannot insert a clip of Pinocchio. But just think about when he gets taken by the fox person and they sell him to the show guy, and he's like not controlling Pinocchio, but just think of that scene. Basically, I'm really bad at explaining, but just think of Pinocchio.
Unlike, now this is different from the movies, unlike in the movie, the Warrens did not perform an exorcism, stating it wasn't possible since their parents weren't religious, but they would attempt to do a seance with Caroline, which is different. I don't know how it's different. Oh wait, seances are more like, oh, you light candles and like a pentagram.
Yeah.
Okay. And actually, fun fact, if you guys haven't watched Sam and Colby, I'm gonna put this in right now.
Plug.
I love them. They actually went down to the basement of the Conjuring House, and there are markings from this seance still there to this day. Anyways, so the Warrens, along with Caroline and Roger, would go down to the basement with the children still there, by the way. The children never leave in the house, so the children could get possessed at any time. And perform the seance. During the seance, Caroline began to speak in tongues before she would have been thrown across the room. After the seance, Roger was concerned about his wife's mental health and would kick the Warrens out. This would be the last time the Warrens would ever go into or onto the Arnold estate afterwards. Fast forward about like 30, 40 years. I think I'm doing the math right. Probably not. Okay. In July of 2013, Lorraine would say in an article for USA Today, quote, "The things that went on there were just so incredibly frightening, it still affects me to talk about today," end quote. And by the way, both Ed and Lorraine are dead. So they can't, like, come
they
and
can't
attack
help
me.
You. Call Ghostbusters instead.
No, you know who you should call? Your mom. I just had to. Okay, so after being kicked out of the house, the family said that the Warrens didn't fix anything but made it worse, which is probably like true if you like do something to provoke a spirit. They're gonna be like, "Oh, I hate this. I'm gonna attack you now." And the main reason that the parents didn't move out was because of the economy, because you know, Great Depression. Nah, it wasn't the Great Depression. Oops, economy troubles because of Reagan. That's true.
And again, I think I'm actually really wrong about the economy thing. So if I did get something wrong, I am terribly sorry, because clearly I had no clue. I still have no clue about what the economy was like during the events of the Conjuring House or the Haunting of the Parent Family. Not sure what I'm calling this episode yet, but yeah.
But in 1980, they would be able to move out of the house and move down to Georgia, which is also really haunted. Why would you move from literally like one of the first 13 colonies to another 13 colony? You're just dumb. And they would never look back at the house. Now, we'll be talking about the Conjuring series, as well as the numerous paranormal investigators that have visited the house since the movies came out.
During the filming of the first movie, the parents were invited to the set. But before leaving, Caroline had gotten cold feet and changed her mind on going, claiming that she didn't want to go on the trip. While the rest of the family was set on being interviewed, Jeria claimed that a rogue wind had swept over the family, causing cameras, lights, and anything that surrounded them had been knocked over. The family had all agreed that it was Bathsheba's curse. Soon after they returned to their hotel, they heard that Caroline had fallen and broke her hip at the exact same time as the wind swept over them. Once the family returned to visit their mother, it was reported that Caroline had sat up and said, "Sheba's curse. She does not want to be exposed."
Paranormal investigations. The Warrens wouldn't be the only paranormal investigators to go to the house. In early 2019, a couple by the name of Corey and Jennifer Hines would purchase the house. Immediately, just like the parents did, they started to experience footsteps and voices. The couple would even perform spirit box sessions where they would get clear responses. Later that year, Zach Bagans and his crew would film their Halloween special for their show Ghost Adventures, which I highly recommend. I really love that show. Zach Bagans is hot. Have you ever seen Zach Bagans? He's really like...
No.
Anyways, during their time in the house, Zach, alongside demonologist, there we go, Carl Johnson, would both witness a black mass move from inside the house. Zach would state, quote, "It was one of the most disturbing things we have ever witnessed," end quote. Soon after the Ghost Adventures crew filmed at the house, many other paranormal investigators mainly from YouTube, have gone to the house. Some of the house's most famous guests was Shane and Ryan from BuzzFeed's Unsolved / Watcher, exploring with Josh, who had become good friends with the owners and had gone to the house a handful of times. And another famous guest was YouTube group Sam and Colby, who, in my opinion, captured the best paranormal evidence in this house. They would go on two separate occasions, once with a medium and another with just the two of them being locked inside the house. Each time, they would catch some of the most shocking paranormal activity, as well as being the first people to do an investigation in the basement, as well as doing a seance in the basement. Before I get too deep into Sam and Colby and explaining them more, I'm going to quickly talk about the photo that was taken. So it was, I believe, their first time in the Conjuring house, and while there, they were doing a spirit box session, which is, if you don't know, you basically ask spirits questions through an EVP machine, which electric voice phenomenons, which is how spirits talk to you. And when you're in those sessions, you're able to, so like, you say a word and it comes through on like a speaker, which is why it's called a spirit box session. You're able to hear them out instead of just, you know, having to play back it. Anyways, that was really hard explaining, but you understand. During the spirit box session, they were in, I believe, the girl's old bedroom, like one of the parent girl's bedroom. It's not really, they don't specify, they say which room they're in, but you get the gist. They were in some sort of room in the house, and while they were there, they were facing into what they called the delivery room or the midwife room, where you would go. No, my mistake. They're upstairs, and the upstairs, the part they were in, was basically like one long hallway. So they were at one end, and they were looking into another bedroom while their friend was taking photos. While taking photos, one of the images caught their eyes. In this image, it shows a child, and well, you can see it if you're watching the video. You can see it, and they show the side by side, and you can clearly see a little boy's face. Now, this is my theory, is that this is a little boy, apparently, that the girls played with and named Manny. I believe this is a little boy spirit that they saw and you were talking to. Anyways, that's all. But on the Reddit forum, r/ghost, many people are believing that this is fake, because apparently ghosts aren't supposed to have heat to them. I'm not 100%. Sure on that off the top of my head or like watching it, but it is some incredible evidence, because in their second video they show the window where the little boy was seen in, and as you can see, I don't have a photo, I probably may put the side by side, but there is a side by side image of the ghost faced, and while they're there, they scan up to the room and it looks like that there is a little boy, but I believe it's just a light, like a fan with a light bulb on top, which I believe they debunked later in the video. I'm not 100% sure, but this is a window they saw it, and when you look at their original video, which is the second one, you can see it's a good height, where there's no way a little boy or anyone can be just, you know, just staring in on them without needing a ladder, or without even being heard, because, you know, ladders, bring it up against wood, it's gonna make a lot of noise. So yeah, I just wanted to clarify that. Also, I'm very sorry if, also, I put two editing clips. This is for viewers that literally are like, you're halfway through the episode and you're finally hearing me say this now. Yes, I'm sorry, but there are two editing parts where I clarify a few things. I should put this at the beginning, but I'm not. Anyways, onwards. Onwards. This is not fucking Disney. I would get sued. No, I'm just kidding. Let's continue with the podcast. Elaborate on Sam and Colby a bit to people who don't know them.
Yeah. So basically, Sam and Colby are two guys who just like to go out and have fun. They have a YouTube channel called Sam and Colby. They invite a bunch of their friends and other people, some famous TikTokers from Canada are on their show occasionally. And they basically just go around exploring different haunted stuff. They've done, like, obviously The Conjuring, they've done the Cecil Hotel, and just stuff like that. stuff that has like lots of ghost experience.
And the paranormal evidence that they captured here was shocking. They brought a thermal camera, which detects heat waves, and they captured the image of a little boy that many people believe to be Manny slash Johnny. None of us know at this point. And they also decided to investigate the backyard after, of course, the claims of these 7 dead soldiers buried there. To this day, there actually are markings on the property where they believe these graves of the 7 soldiers are. But of course, they don't want to, like, dig that up because you don't want to get, like, cursed by some, like, Native American type stuff. Bro. Like, no. Anyways, during this time, they would both actually be in separate parts of the house, with Sam being on the outside and Colby being in the basement alone. No, never go in a basement alone. And they would Colby would be capturing very smart, intelligent EVPs, while Sam caught a black figure moving inside of the house. As of now, the Conjuring House has a new owner, and it's unknown if you can go and stay the night anymore. But if you do go, you can sign your name on a wall.
Yes.
But, I know Corey and his wife, they did move out recently, and now it's, like, this woman. But, yeah, it's kind of weird.
Yeah.
And that was the history slash story of the most famous haunted house in the U.S. The old Arnold estate is still experiencing hauntings and also is still surrounded in mystery. Are there actually 7 dead soldiers buried in the walls or somewhere else on the property? What happened in the basement? Like, what actually happened down there before the parents, maybe? And how many spirits haunt slash live in this house today? I want to thank Libby for coming on. That was a great show. It's a very chaotic show, but it's fine, right?
Yeah. We have fun. And before we leave, mic check.
Shit. Do you want to plug in your socials now?
You guys should follow me on everything I have. It's going to be the same thing for literally almost everything.
Which is what?
LibbyMac13.
This was the story of one of the world's most famous haunted houses in the U.S. Mainly, not the world. To this day, the old Arnold estate is still experiencing hauntings and is also still surrounded in mysteries. Are there actually 7 dead soldiers buried in the walls or somewhere else on the property? What happened in the basement? And how many spirits haunt slash live in the house today? I will be leaving links to every YouTuber we have mentioned, as well as Libby's social media, so if you want to go follow Libby, go right ahead. I don't care if you don't, by the way, but I think Libby would care if you don't follow her, so I suggest you follow Libby. I'm sorry this episode came out a bit later than I hoped. I'm sick right now recording this outro, and I was actually sick while editing it, so that's why it was, like, pushed back so much. But I promise you, like, my New Year's resolution, I'm saying this now, we'll be getting an episode out every 2 weeks or every week at some point. So let's talk about our 4th episode, which will be our Christmas special, which is going to be about the Christmas demon Krampus. I think that's how, yeah, it's Krampus. I don't know why I said Krampus. Krampus comes from the... Basically, his origins is in Austria and Germany, and comes for children who have been bad. Well, Santa, or St. Nicholas, as they call it there, gives the good children gifts and presents. Also, if you are listening to the audio version, I suggest you go to the YouTube channel to hear the outtakes, because you can only hear the outtakes on YouTube that me and Libby recorded. So, hope you enjoy this episode, and I will see you guys for the Christmas special with... hopefully some haunted Christmas music. That sounds so dumb. had Raggedy Ann dolls for the longest. No! And she had them in our house, in our basement.
Let's get a rip to this Nideki household. Rip. Please take a moment of silence for all the fallen soldiers.
Thank you, Libby. So, Lorraine believed that at around the age of 7 or 8, she was able to see people's auras around them, which sounds like some Harry Potter witchcraft stuff. While Ed had grown up in a haunted house, and he became a self-taught demonologist, which is basically a person who studies demons. Now let's get into the real case of The Conjuring.
Follow me. I need clout.
She needs more boyfriends. Okay. That's it. Peace out, bitches.
Oh. You should go.
Is that bitches? No, my intros. My intros are different every time. Outros, intros.
Mic check. I hope you have fun editing that.
I will. It's gonna make
my. I'm gonna sing for you real quick.
Okay.
Your mom likes these nuts.
Oh my god, someone's gonna think we're getting murdered in the school.
For real.
Okay, we're just. Put this
Let's
in the,
just put this in the.
Yeah, we're gonna put this at the end credits. Yeah. I don't care.
We should make our own like sit down, like show where you have a camera.
If we put a camera,
and we get one of those like we get the microphone and we each have one and we just talk about.
Oh my god! Like,
can we do one?
Yeah. That would. What would we call it? The fucking dumb bitches.
No.
Oh my god! Then we can invite like. Random
we can dudes. Invite some guests on our show. We can invite like, I don't know.
Miss T.
We could have met like some teachers. We could be like, we could introduce them. Be like, we'd give them the mic.
Can we do that? Wait, that actually.
We should talk to Mr. O'Shea.
Hi, Mr. O'Shea. I know you're watching this because you love my podcast.
You should do our idea.
Yeah, we're gonna tell you tomorrow.
We'll talk to you about it tomorrow.
We're not even releasing this tomorrow. Anyways, I forgot what I was gonna say. Holy crap. But yeah, follow Olivia on all social medias and. Based on the feedback, I'll maybe, like, bring more people. I'm actually hoping to get Zach Bagans on the show, and maybe. Oh my god, I want to get Sam and Colby on the show. What if I do?
Then you have to invite me.
Yeah, but you would fangirl the entire time.
I would, but it's okay.
Also, if you want me to go... Actually, would you want to come with me to go to a haunted asylum?
Maybe. For sure.
With my dad?
For sure.
At 9 to 12 a.m., we get paranormal equipment from the thing itself. And apparently at the Rolling Hills Asylum place, they touch you. They pull your hair.
Oh.
They do everything.
Just do it.
And that's really creepy because it's like abandoned, but they do ghost tours and shit.
Just do it.
Also, I don't remember. Did your homeroom talk about staying the night at the school?
I wasn't in homeroom.
Oh, you weren't in homeroom?
Nope, I came in late.
They were talking about coming, like, staying the night at the school.
I'm pretty sure the school's haunted.
Bro, the nuns?
It's for sure haunted.
Okay, this is...
Hey, but for real, we should talk to Mr. O'Shea.
Yeah, I'll put this in before I do the outro or after the outro, depending on how I feel.
Should do one episode that's just, like, bloopers. And you should put all the bloopers.
I have actually a lot of bloopers, and it's just literally... Well, I actually got chills from that, ew.
Good.
No. Okay, but no, this school's actually haunted. That was... Okay. Bye.